praying for. You may not know that, but we need God to sort everything out and then to act accordingly in the way he sees fit. David says, save me. He says, hear me. And then he comes up with the reasons and he says, strangers are attacking me. Strangers attacking is kind of strange because they have no strange attacks from strangers. That sounded bad. They have no reason to attack you. They don't know what's going on. This is not neighbors attacking you. They have no reason for coming after you. But they do this. And they've done this to me, and they've done this to you. This is a picture of Joe. Joe attacked me right out of nothing. He looks like a nice guy, though, doesn't he? He's got a nice wife. He was a Sunday school teacher. He's a good Christian man. He's a deacon in the church. And he attacked me for no reason. He attacked my livelihood. He attacked my protecting my family. He attacked me. You know, and I said, Joe, what you're doing is wrong. Here's the verse that says what you're doing is wrong. He says, I don't care what the verse says. You know, I don't like you and you're out of here. You're done. Joe attacked me. Strangers attack us for no reasons, but the real, they're not our neighbors. Neighbors are good people, aren't they? I don't know what these neighbors are doing. Neighbors may have reason to attack you because, you know, you haven't mowed your lawn or, you know, you let your kids play on their yard or whatever. But people attack us because they are enemies of God. That's really why they attack us. They attack us because they're attacking God. They do not see God's presence in their life, and so there's no restraint in their life. In fact, I believe this is what happens when the rapture happens. I believe that Christians go, we leave this world, and then the Holy Spirit, which embodies, indwells all of us. Ronnie, Ashley, behave. Okay? The Holy Spirit lives in our lives, and when Christians are raptured, I believe Christians are raptured, not exactly sure when, but I think the Holy Spirit, a lot of the Holy Spirit's presence goes with us, and people just cut loose because there's no more help. But this is the whole is people thinking there's no God in their life, there's no God who will bring justice, and they attack us for no reasons, except they attack us because they don't know God. But the psalmist, David, knows God. He has grown to understand him. He's grown to love him. He knows that God loves him, and he's grown to trust him. And David declares his confidence in God because of who God is. We don't trust in a plan. We don't trust in a machine. We don't trust in something that will behave in required ways. We trust in a person. And if you know anything about people, people will always do something that you're not going to expect. You know, husbands, wives, you know, they love you, but why don't they do what I want them to do? You know, they do something different. God loves you, but it may not be the thing, he may not answer the way that you want him to answer. He's going to act for your good, but he may not look like he's doing it for your good. So God, who is a person, is good. David trusts in that goodness, but he's not sure how God is going to act. He calls God the sustainer of his life. This when he's talking about people who sought his life. People want you dead. God wants you alive. People want to hurt you. God wants to sustain you. Disease wants to hurt you. God wants to heal you. The world, death, wants you dead. God wants to give you eternal life. God is the sustainer of our life. It's easy to live with problems. It's a whole lot easier to live with problems when we know that there is someone who sustains us. I like whitewater rafting. You know, I like the water. It's not hard work. And it's fun. Okay? Little thrill. I really like the not working part. a lot of things that are fun you don't have to work for. This, you don't have to work much for. They're doing a whitewater rescue. One of the things that we teach people when they're whitewater rafting is that if you fall out of the boat, hang on to your paddle. Now, it's not just because paddles cost $50. And we don't want to pay that. You know, it's because when you're in the water and all alone, you think that paddle is your savior. You know, it's a friend that you can hang on to and cuddle with and hold tight. It will help you. It will sustain you when the problems come. A simple piece of wood. When you have friends on your side, when you have God on your side, you can handle much bigger problems than just floating down the river. You can handle all of the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune that come your way. You can handle the tough things in life when you know that God is on your side. And God is on your side. The prayer of David follows his faith. He knows that God is the sustainer of his life. And so he can pray to God and ask God to save him, to rescue. He knows God's character. And he asks things in line with God's character. So we have to study who God is. We have to study the lives of people who have known God. We have to study the testimonies of people who have walked with God and seen how God behaves in their lives so that we can know how God is going to behave in our life, so that our life can follow God's life. David says that he asked God to let the evil recoil onto the people who are bringing him the evil. You understand recoil. You know, if you've ever shot a gun, you know that the bullet goes that way and the gun goes this way. If you've ever been deer hunting with a scope and you got in your eye too close to the telescope, to the... Kenny's going, Has that happened to you, Kenny? No, okay. I've seen several people with nice black eyes because they got too close to their scope and the recoil hit them in the face. Recoil happens. And what happens in this world is that evil is like a beast that is loosed into the world. And that's how David describes it. He says these evil people have created this animal and they've turned it loose and it's hunting down me. And he says, God, please turn that animal loose on them. Let it go hunt them. Let it go seek them. Let it turn back and bite them. And a lot of times that's how God punishes evil. God believes in an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. We don't have much of that in this world. Some say fortunately, or we'd have a lot of toothless and eyeless people around, but that's not what God meant. What he meant was that the punishment should fit the crime. I believe this is good parenting technique as well. You know, if a child steals something, you make them take it back, you make them pay for it, you make them pay extra for it, you make them apologize.